I actually think we're going to have a major financial crisis 3 or 4 years down the line. And I hope that that acts as a jolt for leaders, 3, 4, 5 years, let's say, as a jolt for leaders to get together and come up with a new system, because I'm pretty convinced we need it.
For The Empire's New Clothes, I'm your host, Brad from MacArthur. We're speaking with Chris Watling today. He founded Longview Economics in 2003. Since then, him and his team have been producing top-notch analysis of markets and financial conditions anywhere from 1 to 2 weeks all the way out to a decade. We look at what is a debt supercycle, we look at the fundamental drivers, and also what might come next. It's much more optimistic than you might think, and so I hope you enjoy. Chris, well, thanks so much for coming on. I really appreciate your time.
A pleasure to be here. Thanks for having me, Bradford. I'm looking forward to it.
Yeah, for sure. So I was prepping for this, and actually very recently, like just before jumping on here, I noticed in your Twitter handle, you are fascinated with financial history. And I thought, what a great way to start with some kind of story, some story that stuck with you and possibly has lessons for today. And so I don't know if anything jumps to your mind.
Yeah, what a great question. Yeah, I love financial history. I think you've got to learn from the past to understand the future. There's no two ways about that, in my opinion.
Yeah.
What goes around comes around is the non-technical term. But yeah, I love bubbles. I think bubbles are fascinating. I remember seeing a fantastic program on a rubber bubble in the middle of Brazil, actually. Which I won't major on, but I remember seeing the town today. They built an opera house and all this wealth, and actually it's all pretty deserted now and quite sad. But of course, this is what bubbles do. My favorite bubble at the moment has got to be the original electric vehicle bubble back in the late 1800s, early 1900s. Huh. And what people don't often realize is that electric vehicles were around before combustion engines. And they were replaced by combustion engines. But in around the sort of 1900-ish, there was the start of one of the first, I think it was Electric Vehicle Corporation of America or something to that name. And the share price just absolutely roofed it, as I like to say in technical language. It did what Tesla's did in August last year. It took off and went to the moon, as Elon would like to say. And of course, then you got all the copycats. You had all the other electric vehicle companies come through loud and fast and quick, and a whole bunch of new companies created, a new supply come on. And then, of course, within 6, 7, 8, 9 years, the Electric Vehicle Motor Company of America had swallowed up the others. Within 10 years, they'd all gone bust and they'd gone to zero. So it's a brilliant example of a bubble. And yeah, I mean, of course, there's just a ton of parallels today. Don't get me wrong. I'm not suggesting Tesla's going to zero, although that's not impossible. And that was certainly seen more likely a couple of years ago, actually. But we've had it today, haven't we? I think it was Lordstown the other day saying that, they don't think they haven't actually got any orders. They thought they did, or they said they did, but actually they haven't. And the share price got hit. That's one of the electric vehicle maker that are around today. So, yeah, I mean, financial history is fantastic. It just never ceases to amaze me how it just keeps on coming around and around, and human psychology, and it just doesn't change.
Yeah, that's such a great point. It tends to be so much more cyclical than we imagine. And I honestly had no idea there was an electric vehicle bubble in the 1800s.
Well, neither did I until recently. I mean, it absolutely surprised me. I mean, Charles Kindleberg is the best. If you know, great financial historian, sadly not with us, but died a few years ago, but had a good life, I believe. But he wrote a lot about bubbles. Manias, Panics and Crashes is his famous book. But he has this framework that reminds me of that electric vehicle and the psychology of bubbles. Whereby, you know, four things create a bubble and one thing tends to end it. And, you know, the preconditions for a bubble tend to be, you know, you need cheap money, first of all. You end up with a lot of leverage. You get a crazy valuation. And there's always a brilliant story. There's always a very good narrative. The narrative evolves. So it starts as you've got to buy this because it's a great story, and it is normally a great story. But by the end of it, it's a great story. You can't let it go. And people shift the boundaries and the valuation metrics, and it becomes all about eyeballs, or it becomes about something else, or whatever. So, and then the one thing that ends bubbles, of course, is when you remove cheap money. That really is, you pop the bubble when that occurs. So yeah, I love financial history, love talking about bubbles and thinking about bubbles and observing them.
Well, let's start with your framework. You've been in financial markets for quite a while now, and so maybe walk us through a bit of what's your overarching big picture framework, and I imagine you start ratcheting it down from there.
Yeah, that's a very big question.
What's your secret sauce, Chris?
What's the secret sauce? If only it was a secret, that would be wonderful. I could be the next McDonald's or Coca-Cola.
Exactly.
What we do is we like. I think where a lot of people go wrong in markets is they, how could I put it? They look at different factors which drive different duration cycles. So what I mean by that is I think there are at least four cycles going on in financial markets at any one time. And we have different ways of forecasting all four. So, for example, we think about markets on a two-week basis, 1 to 2 weeks, literally. It's about greed and fear, what we call risk appetite. But, the market gets ahead of itself. It consolidates its gains. It gives back a bit. It gets a bit greedy, gets a bit more fearful. And then you can think about it on a sort of 2 month or 1 to 4 or 5 months as we think about it, which is a little bit of that greed and fear and a little bit of economics. And then we would think about the economic cycle and the cyclical bull market, which is much more about economics. Cyclical bull markets are, really happen for three reasons. One, the economy is expanding. Two, liquidity is plentiful. And three, there's an absence of shocks. And of course, as your financial advisor tells us all the time, on the whole, markets go up, which of course they do. They're a discounting machine. They discount economic growth, which turns into earnings growth. And then you just have to think about where the valuation and the PE ratio are going. So that third time frame, we spend a lot of time thinking about that economic cycle and where should you put money in the world and have we got a recession coming and what drives recessions and how tight is money? What's the Fed up to and other central banks? Those things are critical on that time frame, the sort of multi-year time frame. And then you get the really big cycles that you see in financial history, the sort of secular cycles, secular bull market in the US or a secular growth cycle in stocks. I like to look at what's called Kondratiev waves in bond markets. You get 35 year wave. So you get all sorts of things on the really long term. So yeah, a lot going on there. Sorry, it's a lot to throw at you.
Yeah. But
I'm trying to make the secret sauce complicated so it's not too obvious.
Precisely. So that big picture cycle, what is the fundamental drivers of that one, of the largest cycles?
The really larger cycles, all sorts of things. So you get long-term trends in demographics. You get long-term trends in interest rates. We get long credit cycles. So, for example, the debt super cycle in the last two, three, four decades. You get geopolitical shifts. You get the cycle of empires in there. Of course, nations rise over decades. Think of Britain rising in the late 1700s into the 1800s and peaking in the late 1800s and then entering decline as we get into the early 1900s and America doing that 100 years later, if you like, and so on. So that plays into all of that, and you get technological cycles. There's an awful lot going on. It makes life fascinating. There's a lot to think about. But there is a pattern and there is a rhythm that you can see in that. So that's fascinating.
And so do you, looking at, let's say, the U.S. of potentially being a declining power, these things are impossible to really know, but do you factor that into your financial models or frameworks currently, or is that such a big force? It's like kind of there, but not really at the moment.
I wouldn't, so our main forecasting time horizon is over the economic cycle. So the sort of cyclical bull market and the cyclical bear market. We like to think about these longer cycles, and they might inform the thematics within the cyclical bull market. So, for example, at the moment, we're quite keen on commodities. You know, I think bond yields are trending higher, and so on and so forth. But really, you know, the America in decline story I find fascinating, and I love reading about and studying the cycle of empires. But getting that into an investment thesis is quite hard. Most people's time frame, it doesn't work. And if you think about it, I can see why people would argue that maybe America's in decline, but they argue that when Russia was powerful in the 50s and 60s, you know, it was argued with Japan in the 70s and 80s, and now, of course, it's China that's going to take over the world. So, you know, it may well happen. I personally don't think China's going to win, but I can see why people make the argument that America's in decline, but including that in investment thesis is pretty ambitious, to be honest, and not really realistic in terms of my day job.
Yeah. And so let's take it to the next step. And so you mentioned the super debt cycle, and you also just put an article out recently in the Financial Times, something about a reset of the super debt cycle. So first, help walk us through what is a super debt cycle.
Yes, well, I'm gonna call it a debt super cycle if you don't mind, just to be particular.
Oh yeah, sorry. No. that's okay. Me swapping the words. Yeah, exactly.
I mean, I think it works just as well that way, super debt cycle and debt super cycle. I don't think it really matters. I mean, it's got the same implications. So what is it? Well, I think increasingly people are familiar with the idea that the world's become very indebted in recent years. So if you take American debt levels and you went back, and I'll give you the rough numbers because I don't remember the exact ones, but say debt to GDP in early 1980s was maybe about 100%, roughly. It was about the debt levels in aggregate in the economy. And what I'm talking about there, I'm talking about government debt and private sector debt. And of course, the private sector is companies and households. So household debt, company debt, and government debt was probably roughly 100% of GDP early 1980s, maybe a tad more. And of course, what we've seen over the last four decades or so is that's risen steadily in America and indeed across the world. And in contrast to what it done in the previous, you know, several decades before that, which had been fairly stable around a mean, we've seen a steady uptrend in debt levels relative to GDP over the last three or four decades globally. So in America, I think the number now is, I forget exactly, maybe 280% of GDP, something like that. You would make the same point about the UK, about France, about China, about Japan. I mean, the numbers are bigger in Japan, about Italy. It's a very long list. It's a global phenomena of the global economy becoming much, much more indebted than it's ever been. And it's been a continual process. Like all these things, it's not a straight line. You go up, you pause, you move up again. But essentially across the globe, and we have this theme actually that we do incorporate in some of our thinking, which is what I call pass the debt parcel. So different parts of the world over the last four decades have been becoming more indebted and taken up the running on picking up the debt, and others have paused, and then the baton's been passed back and so on. So globally, though, debt to GDP has done something that is utterly unprecedented. So if ever people want some reading on debt, history of debt, I recommend David Graeber, who's absolutely fantastic, sadly passed away, I think, last year, who's an anthropologist, and he wrote a book called The History of Debt, the 5,000-year history of debt, something like that. I don't know if you're familiar with the book.
5,000 years of debt or something like that.
I can see it on my bookshelf, but because I've got my glasses on, I can't read it. But it's a fantastic book. It's maybe 10 or so years old. Now, one of the key takeaways I got from that book is there's been debt cycles forever. Governments have become indebted to fund wars. In fact, they come off monetary anchors, gold anchors in the past, or silver anchors, and I guess we'll come to that, but they've come off these anchors, built up massive indebtedness, and it's always been government debt, and then they've basically devalued they basically paid the debt down very quickly and then gone back on the monetary anchor a few years after the war. You have that in history, but you never have in history any examples before the last few decades where the private sector becomes massively indebted. And of course, this is really a very big part of what's happened in the last three or four decades. So it is utterly unique in 5,000 years of history. You go all the way back to the Babylonians. It hasn't happened anything like to the extent that we have. And it's very dramatic and it's very interesting. And it speaks a lot to what's going on today in the global economy.
So in one way, we truly don't know where we're headed in some sense of the word. There's not really a specific roadmap of when the private and government is this indebted for this long. And so perhaps walk us through, you're nodding your head, I just said we don't know what's going to happen, but now I'm going to ask you, what are some possible ways to relieve this? Obviously, there's defaulting, I suppose there's inflation, restructuring. Are these like our three options here?
Absolutely. And of course, there are some parallels you can make in history before I answer your question. And of course, you can make the parallel that we've had a fiat currency system really since the end of Bretton Woods in 1971, whereby the world has been on a dollar standard, basically, with no anchor. And of course, that's a really important point. Normally, prior to 1971, you had a gold anchor. Bretton Woods was the dollar was linked to gold. All other currencies were linked to the dollar. Before World War II, you had a semi-gold standard that you went back on between World War I and World War II globally. Pre-World War I, it was the hard gold standard all the way back into the mid-late 1800s, depending on which country you were. And you can go back throughout history. There's always been an anchor. But there's always been countries that have tried a fiat currency. So there are, in fact, I think 200 examples of prior fiat currencies before 1971, and every single one of the 200 has failed. So there's no examples in history of fiat currencies that have succeeded. And the reason they failed, and I guess this is the sort of semi-parallel, is because they end up printing money and finding it hard to resist the temptation to create new money. Now, it may not be called debt because you're creating new currency, but there's a parallel with what we're doing today, because when we create debt in the private sector, we also create new money. That's the way the system works today. So there are parallels. There are slight differences. They've never had private sector indebtedness, but you have had printing of a ton of money in those 200 prior examples when those fiat currencies fail. So that is a historical example. And then to your question, how do you resolve this from here? You know, it's a big question. It's hard. Yes. It's not easy. There are no easy answers. There really aren't. But you're quite right. You either restructure debt, which means you default on some of it, or you inflate your way out of it, or you keep printing, I guess, and you have monetary collapse. Or ideally, in an ideal world, you grow your way out of it. That was the post-World War II experience when governments in the UK, the Western Europe and the US had high debt levels. We grew our way out of it largely. But then you had a following wind for demographics. You had much higher productivity growth. You had a lot of good things going on, which I don't think we've got today. We've got much bigger challenges on that front. So growing your way out of it is going to be really, really hard. And we've got to this situation whereby, we're sort of printing. For every unit of GDP growth, we need 3 to 4 units of debt. So the efficiency of debt is really declining. I mean, that would have been 1 to 1 in the early 80s.
Yeah,
it's now 1 to 3 or 4. So we're in a sort of slippery slope. It's not a great situation, and I think we need what I call the Great Reset. So I called it that because the Klaus fellow who runs the World Economic Forum. You know, the well-known chap, I forget what his name is now, the Davos guy, who talked about the idea of a great reset, building back better. Mm-hmm. This thing that all politicians have got hold of now. They all sing from the same hymn sheet, build back better, build back greener, all that sort of stuff. Well, I think the real great reset should be actually will solve a lot of the world's ills if we reset the monetary system and develop a new system with this anchor, and we can talk about that in more detail if you want. And at the same time, we cancel some of this debt. So if you go back in history, there's often debt jubilees. Every 50 years in the Jewish calendar and the Jewish society, going back in history, they used to cancel all the debt that was owed and start again and have a reset. Mm-hmm. Now, I think it's unrealistic to think we can cancel all the debt, but there's definitely some easy pickings there. So, you know, I think we need a new monetary system to be designed. So we need like a new Bretton Woods conference where all the leaders of the world in 1944 got together and designed the Bretton Woods system that lasted through to 1971 from 1946. We need to sit down, come up with a new system, and associated with that, cancel some of the debt that's in place in the world today.
Fascinating. So do you see that as more likely of an outcome than inflating the debt away? Or they kind of 50-50?
Yeah, what a great question. I actually think we're going to have a major financial crisis 3 or 4 years down the line. And I hope that that acts as a jolt for leaders, 3, 4, 5 years, let's say, as a jolt for leaders to get together and come up with a new system, because I'm pretty convinced we need it. And the current system we've got today, as I said, I think is what is driving a lot of the wealth and income inequality in society, and the high house prices. It's all linked. It's all the same thing. It's all playing with funny money and, and fiddling with the monetary system. Yeah. And the bubbles that you see, yeah.
Is this an accepted view of a debt supercycle? I don't see a lot of folks. I see some folks ignoring it. I don't see a lot of folks coming out and saying, this is this weird theory. I don't really agree with it. We should keep doing what we're doing, and we're going to just continue to grow and be great. When you published the article in Financial Times, is there any pushback of like, oh, Chris, we're not in a debt supercycle, things are just fine? Or is it kind of just crickets?
To be fair to the FT, it's not their kind of article that they typically publish. There was a bit of a pushback. It was a challenge getting it into the paper, but I'm grateful.
Nice
for
job
them
getting
for doing
it in.
It.
Yeah,
I'm very grateful they did it. Actually, I thought it's not really their main sort of bag. But I think to be fair to the FT, I've noticed that many people in society, I think since the financial crisis, have been much more open to ideas about. This is the whole premise of Bitcoin, of course, really, the original premise, that the financial system is a manipulation of asset prices, and that governments print money to get out of crises. And as we saw in the financial crisis in 07 to 09, it's, the profits get taken by the few and the losses get socialized and picked up by the many, that sort of slogan. So Bitcoin comes out all of that. The idea that you have Bitcoin is essentially a monetary system with an anchor. There's a limited supply. There's no more than 21 million, full stop. So, that's it. So it's fantastic in that sense. I don't actually think Bitcoin will ever be adopted as a fully accepted monetary system, but that's a different discussion perhaps that we can come back to if you want to. But I think, my point about the great reset and the debt supercycle, I would say there's a lot of people in financial markets who buy it. I think there's a lot of the economic thinking would not buy it. It's much more about the Keynesian manipulation of demand. And in fact, that's troubling. I don't think it's a focus of the Feds or the Bank of England. And I think it's a great shame, because I think they've really missed a trick. How money is created is utterly fascinating and central. And sadly, no one really talks about it. I am quite pleased to say that the British Parliament, our MPs in our Parliament in 2014, I think it was, had a debate about a private member's bill put forward by, Steve Baker, who's an MP, about money creation. They debated money creation in Parliament in 2014. Which is really cool. Now, sadly, Sadly, only 30 MPs turned up, and I think there's about 650 in Parliament. So,
oh my gosh,
it tells you that probably answers your question. I mean, I've discussed this with one or two MPs, and often it's just blank faces. It's not something people are familiar with. There's a mantra in the UK, for example. I don't know about other places in the world, but you know, our view is that our high house prices are all about the fact that, you know, we've got a lack of homes being built. That's the view. And you can prove that that's incorrect. It's not to do with the supply, lack of supply of actual housing. It's to do with the massive supply of mortgage debt, which is all linked into how this debt supercycle works, how the banks work today that's different, and how the whole system's been different in the last two or three decades. And we can dig into that if that's helpful, because I think that really explains what drives the debt supercycle at its heart, and why we have it now and we haven't had it in the last several millennia.
Yeah, let's dig into that a little bit. I think that would be a really good enlightenment. Like, what is the driver of this beast?
Yeah, what's the driver of the beast? It's fascinating because I always like to joke. There's a place called my Swiss French pronunciation is wrong, but it's Basel. I call it Basel, but I think they call it Baal. It's a small town in Switzerland on the border with France and Italy, I think, or just France. And to be honest, if you didn't go to Switzerland or know about the Basel Accords, you probably never have heard of it. But actually, it's probably the most important place in the world in the last few decades, other than perhaps the White House and where President Xi lives and one or two places like that, because it's where the men in grey suits, as I like to say, have changed all the rules about how banks work over the last two or three decades, which has had an incredible effect on house prices. And let me explain. The underpinnings of the debt supercycle are basically threefold. Firstly, we have a monetary system that doesn't have an anchor. So as I explained, prior to 71, Bretton Woods, gold standard, all that. We don't have an anchor. Mm-hmm. So without an anchor, countries can create lots of liquidity and create money. So when a commercial bank makes a loan, it creates new money. So two agents in an economy can create new money. One is the central bank, which we've all been watching, QE and all that sort of stuff. And the other is the commercial banks. And in the UK, for example, 97% of the money supply over the last few decades has been created by the commercial banks. So that's point number one. It's pretty amazing. So
makes me want to be a bank.
I tell you, there's tons of books about, I've got one on my bedside written Volcker recommended in his book that I read, and I forget who wrote it, but it was basically how to rob a bank. The best way to rob a bank is to own it. which is essentially what I'm talking about. So point one is we haven't had an anchor. So commercial banks can create new money. And in the old days under the gold standard, when you create money, you create debt. So in the old days, if you created too much liquidity and too much debt, you ended up with a current account deficit and you'd have a run on your gold. Countries would demand gold. You'd have to, and then that would tighten up your system because your gold was basically your base money supply. And if you had a run on it, you had less monetary. It's a form of monetary tightening. It slowed the domestic economy, got you back into balance. That was essentially how monetary standard worked. In a world where all the Western economies across the globe can create new money and create new liquidity, that problem goes away. So point number one, there's no monetary anchor. Point number one, driving the debt supercycle. Point number two is we've had financial sector deregulation since Margaret Thatcher and since Ronald Reagan. I have this little sort of story from a mortgage queue to an eighth. So if you go back to the 1970s in Britain, and I'm sure this was the same in France and all sorts of countries. So you go back to the 1970s and you wanted to take out a mortgage. And my old man tells me this story and relates it to me. And he sat in the queue and absolutely, I've heard many people accredit this one. So you would save money if you wanted to have a mortgage, save money into a building society. and lots of people would be saving, and then everyone got in a queue and you took your turn, and when it was your turn, there was enough money in the bank, you got a mortgage, off you went, you bought your house. Okay, so that kind of makes sense, doesn't it? That's old school economics.
Everyone contributed.
And in fact, that's where the original building society came from. It started in a pub in the UK. There were 16 people. They all decided they wanted to buy a house. None of them could afford it. They all said, we'll all save until we've all got a house, and we'll draw straws to see who gets the first mortgage. So that was the original building society, started in a pub in the UK, and then became building societies or credit unions, as sometimes people call them. I think in France, probably in America, do you call them credit unions? I think maybe not. Mutuals.
Well, we certainly have credit unions. I don't know if that was the inception of them, but.
Yeah, I suspect so. So anyway, the point is people save. So anyway, Margaret Thatcher, Ronald Reagan turn up in 1980. We start deregulating and allowing commercial banks to enter the mortgage market. So in the 1970s, if you were Barclays Bank in the UK, or you were Midland Bank or whatever, you weren't allowed to make mortgage lending. All you did was corporate lending and a little bit of stuff on the side. So in 1980, the commercial banks enter the market, and you know, they start making some mortgage loans and taking on the building societies. And then we get this thing called Basel. You know, I mentioned that, the reason I mentioned Basel, the Basel Accords, which are to do with the way the financial system works, come into effect towards the end of the 1980s, round one, Basel one. And what Basel one does is it says, you know, we're going to run banks differently. We're going to have risk weightings of assets, and we're going to give you risk weightings for certain types of assets. And then you're going to, you're going to generate some capital to support that, depending on how risky we think things are. So the original judgment of Basel was, a mortgage loan is half as risky as corporate debt. So if you make a corporate loan, you need 100% risk weighting. If you make a mortgage loan, you need 50%. So in other words, you need twice as much capital to make a corporate debt loan as you need a mortgage loan. Now that changed there, Basel II, that 150, then went to 135 on a mortgage. So mortgage 35, corporate still 100. And then we had Basel III, and the guys in the suits from Switzerland were even nicer. They said, I tell you what, you're a big bank. You're very sophisticated. You work it out. So they basically said, you run the models, you have the models you want. And of course, the big bank.
And there they are, fist pumping under the table. Like, yeah.
Yeah, what a great idea. They love that. So they got down to 12%. So this is the idea. So 12% is an eighth of the amount of capital that you would need relative to 100%. So we go from a mortgage queue in the 1970s, where people got to save, to an eighth in terms of the amount of capital you need to make a mortgage loan as a commercial bank. And the other key, of course, is at this stage, you know, there's no liquidity restrictions, there's no monetary anchor. So commercial banks can make a mortgage loan whenever they like, as long as they've got that eighth of capital to support it. So what you have is you have a commercial banking system in the UK that in 1980, pre-deregulation, was basically a corporate lender and one or two other things. And that by the whole banking system as a whole, today, if you look at the UK loan book of the UK commercial banking system, it's about 70% mortgage debt. So, and by the way, the banks relative to GDP have gone from, I don't know, 50, 60% in 1980. They're now about 350% of GDP. Now, to be fair, part of that's overseas lending, but still, mortgage debt as a share of GDP has gone from 10% in 1980 to about 100 or so. Well, I think it's about 70 or 80% now in the UK. So the biggest driver of house price gains is the massive supply of new debt and new mortgages and new money into the system. And one of the biggest component parts of the debt supercycle is the household's indebtedness, which is mostly mortgage debt, which has gone from around 10-ish percent of GDP to 100-ish percent of GDP today. So there's that. Whoa. And there's corporate, and yeah, exactly. That's and then the final piece of the puzzle. So you've got the anchoring, unanchoring of the system, the deregulation of banking effectively in the Basel Accords. And the final piece is we adopted, of course, consumer price inflation targeting from the early 1990s onwards. and forgot about money supply metrics, which is where you pick up all this money creation and debt creation. So they got sidelined at central banks, and central banks focused on consumer price inflation targeting. So, and then, of course, they took the house prices out of the consumer price indices. So so that's the driver of the debt super cycles, and that's why we are where we are today, in my opinion. And that's what we need to change. We need to unravel that system and refix it and re-anchor it and change it. And, of course, there's a lot of vested interests in that system. You'll be, I'm sure you'll be aware, the biggest lobbyists in America is the finance sector. So, you know, there's all these issues. When you come to the decline of empire, there's all these issues about a parochial interest in politics and a lack of bipartisanship.
Yeah, everyone's invested in it continuing on in that same process.
Exactly.
And so the question that really stands out for me in all this, well, it's a simple question, but probably not a simple answer. Where does the risk lie in that? Is it in the homeowners and their mortgages, or is it more of a systemic overall just risk, or is it up in the sovereign level from all these supporting the mortgages over the decades now? Like, if we've deregulated so intensely and we've flooded so much debt into these, well, specifically mortgages, but all these different markets, ultimately, where does that risk lie?
Yeah, it's a good question. I think if what we've seen is, you know, whenever that risk surfaces, you know, the government steps in. I think, and what we've seen is
ultimately put that fire out.
Yeah, put the fire out. Exactly. We push the risk all the way up to the sovereign. So, I think the risk is in the currency. It's in the it's in the sovereign. It's in the reserve currency status. And I think this is where you start to get into the idea that, you know, America does, sadly, I think, exhibit a lot of the signs of, you know, end of empire, towards end of empire. You know, I don't know if you read any William Durant. It may be a name you're familiar with, writing in the 60s.
Heard of him, yeah.
Yeah, William and Ariel Durant. And they had this lovely phrase in their book that's sort of, I forget what their book was called. I think it's The History of the World, I think, something like that. And there's this lovely phrase about how countries come and countries go and empires come and empires go. And empires start with, you know, fight commerce and energy and thrusting, and everyone's on the same page and everyone's winning. And they end up, you know, they go through this cycle and they end up what they call luxuriating in finance, which I think is just the perfect term for where we are today, really. You know, the American system, the Western system, but really led by the American system, is luxuriating in finance. You know, we have a president now. You have a president in America who has spent 30% of, well, between him and Trump in his last year and Biden as he's got going, we're about 30% of GDP in fiscal stimulus in 2 years. These numbers are absolutely incredible. And they're the only parallels. I mean, they're just incredible. But it's all funded by newly created money. So, you know, we're in a very strange phase where we're in helicopter money. It's a very troubling phase, I think, for America. I personally hope and want America to remain as the world's hegemon because, quite frankly, I don't really fancy China being in charge. But but, you know, there's a lot of troubling signs. There really is. And Kindleberger's brilliant on this. Kindleberger talks about seven preconditions that you have in place before a country starts to lose its reserve currency status and its world economic primacy, before a country starts to stop being top dog. And amongst those seven, one of them is over-indebtedness. Another is currency debasement. Another is financialization of the system. And the flip side of financialization is a deterioration in your manufacturing base, you know, and then, you know, another is political parochialism and a lack of political unity and all this sort of stuff. And then you get foreign policy overreach and so on. So you can see a lot of that stuff is, you know, it's really in place today in America. And it's,
I don't know what you're talking about.
Yeah, you got it all over your website. So you know exactly what I'm talking about.
So, you speaking about those three things you kind of need for this debt super cycle. I said that right. Yeah.
Yeah. Absolutely.
The Super Mario debt cycle. Yeah. So it's hard to kind of pin it on one. I think you're so correct. You need all three. And it makes me think it really just, they all together take away the ability to self-throttle and self-regulate through economic mechanisms of what you mentioned earlier of when you're anchored to something. Yep. Someone starts taking too, you're too indebted, your gold leaves, you enact policies to slow that, and you get back more in line. And I think it's so interesting how it's such a new thing. Fiat currency is really what we're doing, and you've pointed out so well during our discussion. And people who talk about, oh, we need to go back to a gold standard, I'm not necessarily an advocate of, I don't really know what we need to go back to. But certain folks are certainly advocating for that. And you see them as they're quite taken out, like in political terms or just in social terms, they're seen as the outcast, they're dissenters. We need to isolate ourselves from those people. They're crazy. It ends up being this fringe idea when really this fringe idea is this experiment we've been doing for the last number of decades. So my question to you is, why do we look down on these people who simply say, hey, there's a way that we can actually flourish for a longer period of time and have a more healthy system? They're like pointing this out, and yet we see them as like a crazy gold person or something.
It's amazing, isn't it? Well, I mean, actually, you reminded me, of course, it was Alan Greenspan, who, as we know, was chairman of the Federal Reserve for mm-hmm. a long time, a decade plus, I think. And, you know, actually, I think in the 1960s, he wrote about an essay about gold and economic freedom or something like that. Or Warren Buffett's father, equally, same sort of mindset. So it was interesting that someone like Greenspan could turn. He was a big adherent of Ayn Rand and the libertarian ideas that go with that. He could change from that to being a political beast as Fed governor, as he was, really. But, you know, and people argue about how good he was as a Fed chairman. So that I think that's an he's almost an illustration of how you have to adapt to the system to survive in it. It's almost like the system has its own momentum, and there's no way you'll be spat out by that system if you try and stand heavily against it, unless there's a crisis and everyone's like, oh my word, what happened? We need to rethink. You know, it's the old saying, isn't it? Never let a good crisis go to waste. So it's amazing to me. But let me put it to you this way. I have many wonderful friends in Germany who are fantastic people, but there's a country that became largely overran by an ideology in the 1930s and 40s. It just seems you couldn't imagine that happening today, but it just shows you how nations can almost, I'm not an expert on this, obviously sociologists and psychologists would tell you, it becomes very difficult to bat against the mainstream, doesn't it? I think Greenspan's probably a good example of that.
Interesting. That's a super valid point. And, you know, I actually just spoke with a fellow, the interview should come out before this one comes out, David French. I don't know if you're familiar, but he points out similar things, but in politics in the U.S. of how the right wants to change the left, wants to change the right, but neither are going to do that. It must be changed from within. But the internal dissenters are the most viciously attacked, more than the other side. And so I almost wonder if we have similar things going on here. And that really, it kind of brings back to what you said earlier of you didn't put words on it like this. And so I don't want to put words in your mouth, but something along the lines of the Fed and the more academic side is less interested in, say, an article like you wrote in the Financial Times. Whereas financiers and practitioners and speculators are more like, no, that defines perfectly what's going on. And I almost wonder if it's because there's a certain level of ego or identity or reputation tied to that. And so saying, hey, this is exactly what's going on. We're in a debt super cycle. It's not good. There isn't necessarily a great outcome. We need to take steps is admitting fault. It's admitting my whole career has been supporting this thing.
Yeah.
And so I wonder if that is an unfortunately very powerful part of this, why we kind of keep marching down the path.
I think it is. I mean, I think you make a really good point. And I would agree that's a great division between the academic economics profession and and the financiers and speculators who broadly sort of see it differently. I think if you're in markets, you're judged every day on your view. And it's, you know, if it's wrong, you've got to change it. Markets are a great humbling experience for many of us in many occasions. Whereas you can hold an academic view for your entire life, argue away till you're blue in the face, and if you're super bright, you can probably work out a way around it. It reminds me of, which is sad actually, because I always think the reason we have so many economic theories is because they all work at different times, but none of them work all the time. So they're all interesting. That. Yeah, they've all got something to contribute. But it also reminds me of the fact, I think I read this stat, I think it was the OECD that produced it, maybe not, but essentially of all the economists working in the world today, whether it's in academic institutions or central banks or financial markets, in fact, maybe it's not the academic ones, maybe it's those working as practicing economists. I think something like high 90% of them have either worked in a central bank or an IMF or Treasury Department of a government before they've gone out into financial markets or whatever. So of all the practicing economists, you know, they've all been taught the same thing. And of course, they're brilliant guys who love to think outside the box. But on the whole, they're all in the same box. And that's why you get groupthink, I think. I mean, that's part of it. And to be honest, most of them probably studied under, you know, I mean, there was Bernanke, Fisher, wasn't it, who used to be on the Fed, Stan Fisher. And, I mean, I studied Stan Fisher's textbook when I was at university in the 80s. So there's kind of a thread that goes through so much of this. That, to be honest, that's great thing about the financial crisis. You've got all that new, there's that new economic thinking, isn't there? There's a new economic think tank that I think George Soros funded or someone like that. And so you are getting new thinking. But, you know, I think at one of our universities in the north of England, we have an economic department that studies crashes in financial markets. And, you know, I know people always do this, but and debt cycles. So it's changing. But, yeah, I think you make a really, really good point there. There's a consensus and there's too much vested in careers. It's hard. It must be hard if you've thought something all your life. It's hard. It's like being an atheist all your life, and then suddenly, wow, maybe there is a God.
Yeah, no,
it's hard to tell your friends.
I can empathize. Yeah. I can empathize with that. Like the times that you kind of take that step back, and you're like, oh, it's really easy to just keep marching forward and doing what you're doing, and as you say, and so to kind of tie this up in a bow, the best outcome you see, which sounds counterintuitive, is a crisis, but not a crisis that's wasted or just, because I think a lot of folks that talk about something like a debt super cycle or a great reset or whatever, there's this weird glorification they get out of it of like screw you guys, you mess up the system, I want to see everyone suffer. I don't get that at all from you. And so walk me through a little bit of like the perfect outcome almost is like we could have a crisis and that can cause us to act and solve these problems and go into like a much better system.
I mean, the perfect outcome would be one step before that, which would be political leaders to say, we don't think this system's working. Let's get together and change it. Sadly, I don't think there's any sign of that happening, but would be wonderful if it did. But perhaps the next best outcome is, as you say, sadly, a crisis, because people suffer and that's not good. But a crisis that wakes people up and wakes leaders up and brings them to the table and think about this system. And the good thing, I think the good thing about the last 10 years post-financial crisis is there is a lot of different thinking leaking into the mainstream. I don't think it's properly got there yet, but you can feel it coming in. Lots more people arguing about why house prices are going up because there's too much debt. You know, that wasn't there 15 years ago at all. All things like that. I think that's really positive. Lots of people who look at the madness of negative interest rates. I always like to think, I like to think of Alice in Wonderland. I don't know if you've seen that film.
Not for a while.
Yeah. So they have the White Queen, don't they? And the White Queen says she can believe six impossible things before breakfast. And I mean, basically to me, this is the financial system today. It's like six ridiculous things that 20 years ago you would have said would never happen. And they're all happening and we don't even think about it anymore. You know, rates are negative and 10-year yields are negative. The Swiss National Bank is one of the biggest owners of Apple and Facebook with newly created money. You know, the list is long. So I think, you know, the point is the fringe thinking, which I think is the correct thinking, is seeping into the mainstream. So I hope on the next crisis that financial leaders have another Bretton Woods. They sit down, they cancel debt, they reset the system, and they anchor in some way and design new rules. So, you know, and the reality is monetary policy, international monetary systems, there's no perfect answer. But about every 30, 40 years, they get tired and you need a reset, you need a new system. So I think it would be brilliant for the West. It would be brilliant for liberty. It would be fantastic for prosperity. And it would be a brilliant way of addressing the income and wealth inequality in actually quite a positive way. So let's hope they do that.
Yeah, we'll see. Love that. Let's hope that happens. So, Chris, thank you so much for joining today. I want to say you it was like last 20 years you've been doing market analysis, and behind you folks can see the long view and short view. And so you separate a lot of your work into the terms are so perfect. It's the more long economic and financial view and then the 1 to 2 week. And so maybe give us a little bit of like, what do you do on your day to day? And then where can folks find some more of your work?
Yeah. So the work's all obviously on the website, longviweconomics.com. We've got Twitter handles at Longview Econ and LView Econ, two Twitter handles you can find us on. We do twice a week videos on YouTube on Short View Trading, where we think about markets on a 1 to 2 week basis and on a day by day basis. So, you know, as I say, we think about markets on four timeframes. So every morning we're thinking about the next 1 to 2 weeks. We like to try and forecast S&P futures direction, and we do trading recommendations on that. Then we do longer term investment recommendations. How should you run a global asset allocation portfolio or a global pension portfolio with a sort of 1 to 2 year plus time frame, that kind of stuff. And then on top of that, we have what I call the sort of thinking, thinking about the long term and thinking about the key issues and stuff like that. So it's a whole range of stuff. It's all on the website. We're actually zipping the website up now to make it look even, make it more accessible and easier to understand. So,
oh, cool.
So if you don't put this out too quick, we might get there.
Awesome. Well, you know, I think it's so cool you guys do the short term and long term. Most folks kind of settle in one bucket, but you guys are like, no, we're gonna do it
all.
And well, and what's crazy is, so I watched, preparing for this, I watched an interview you did with Real Vision in January 2020, and you gave a prediction for the year, S&P 500, 10 to 20%, and ended up being 15%, right in the middle. And little did you know it would be such a ridiculous year.
Yeah, no, I knew the pandemic was coming. That was an easy call. I had no idea. Of course, you're absolutely right. To be fair, we're blindsided by the pandemic. That was a bit of a hole in our armory, but we've learned fast. But yeah, what a year. Extraordinary. Fascinating.
Totally crazy. All right, Chris. Well, thanks again so much, and you have a good rest of your day.
Yeah, thanks, Bradford. I appreciate your time, too.
Well, it looks like you stuck with us to the end, and thank you so much. Please like, subscribe, rate, and review. It honestly is the best way to help us reach a broader audience, and that's the only way we can keep bringing you good content every single week, and that is our goal here. So we look forward to seeing you next week, and thank you so much.